Election time. So cast your vote. Selection time. What matters most? We now know. Our leaders understand. They all want GP to have a helping hand. 100 more practices, cutting red tape. Millions of appointments with less than a week's wait. Thousands more GPs from the magic GP tree that only blooms in election time. It's an election fantasy. But before you get excited that things are going to change, there's something you should know about the things we say. We're just making it up. We're making it up. The words coming out don't mean diddly squat. We're just making it up. We're making it up. If you think this will come true, then we're gonna disappoint you. We're making it up, we're just saying words so we can get heard. Doesn't matter what we say, it won't happen anyway. We're making it up, we're making it up. Just making it up. I'll say anything to please if it gets me on TV. We're making it up, ba 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 da ba. We're making it up, ba 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 da ba. We're making it up, ba 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 da ba. Ba ba da ba, we're making it up. Ba 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 ba. It's Friday, the 7th of June, and this is the Hot Topics Podcast. Welcome to the Hot Topics Podcast from NB Medical. Neal Tucker here, and thank you everyone for listening to this episode. I really like the research we're going to talk about today. We've got two pieces of research that look directly at day-to-day practice, and then a third study that just goes to show why we shouldn't make assumptions. In NB Medical News, lots going on at the moment. So we've got pretty much all of our courses coming up online over the next few weeks. So do check out the website. We just yesterday did our new men's health course. So if that's of interest, then do check that out. That's available now on demand. Tomorrow, so actually the 8th of June, depending on when you're listening to this, I'll be one of the presenters doing our latest Hot Topics course online, live, for you to join us, and that'll be available on demand shortly afterwards as well. Then in the next couple of weeks, we've got our new to general practice course. That's great if you're just finishing your GP training, or if you're a newly qualified GP, do come and join us for that. We've got our women's health course on Friday, the 14th of June, our diabetes course on the 15th of June. Then the week after, we've got our abnormal blood test course, our managing obesity and overweight course. We've got our palliative and end of life care course. It's a new course we've done. That's on June the 27th. Blimey, it's all going on. Now, let me think. Has anything happened in the news since the last podcast? Oh yeah, they've called a general election. I promise you, I'm not going to talk about the election. You're probably getting it from every angle at the moment. You're probably subscribed to 20 different election cycle podcasts already. The best thing I can do is focus on the medicine. And there has been interesting medical news as well. So yesterday in the news, there was this report about a major breakthrough in the understanding of inflammatory bowel disease. 1% of the population is affected. Numbers keep on rising, and now they've located the gene that is responsible for driving inflammation in macrophages, which then causes the IBD. It's another example of how genomics is peeling back some of the mysteries of medicine and allowing a deeper understanding. And as they point out in the report, it also allows scientists to then try and specifically target those genes with medications to try and solve the problem. It's going to be years before this exciting finding translates into treatments for patients, but it's another example of how looking at genetics is starting to infiltrate into day-to-day practice. So along with things like clopidogrel resistance, which we've been talking about on the Hot Topics course over the past year, also genetic testing before people start azathioprine to make sure that they have adequate levels of this TPMT enzyme that helps metabolize azathioprine and ensures that you're not then going to give a toxic dose. There's been other research published on drug metabolism recently too. So you can do a genetic test and look to see how people metabolize a variety of different medications. And then with that knowledge, you can make alterations to the dose to make the drug safer for an individual. The next part of those studies are moving on from safety to efficacy and looking to see if we can identify who is going to respond best to certain medications. And then we really are into a whole new realm of personalized medicine. And I think it's going to be a very interesting and exciting future. Okay, let's get straight on with the research now. And we're going to kick off with a paper in this month's BJGP. Another great edition, this time focusing on children and young people. This paper is about asthma and it's titled Post-Hospitalization Asthma Management in Primary Care, a Retrospective Cohort Study. There's also an editorial on asthma in children in the same edition, really strongly worded, highlighting the avoidable death of a 10-year-old boy with asthma. There were multiple times during which his asthma management could have been improved over many, many months, but he was repeatedly treated for acute asthma without the longer-term needs being addressed. And all the warning signs were there. He'd required hospital admissions for severe asthma attacks. He'd been given multiple courses of prednisolone from the GP practice. He'd received multiple reliever inhalers. All of the significant warning signs were there that this is a person with poorly controlled asthma, but not just poorly controlled asthma, but potentially fatal asthma as well. This is an area I've got quite a lot of interest in. And over the last few years, I've been writing and updating the respiratory sections of the Hot Topics book. And we've done quite a lot on asthma in the Hot Topics course. And the data repeatedly shows that asthma outcomes in the UK are not that good. And I'm sure there's multiple things that contribute to this. Lack of knowledge is not the primary problem here, I think. And I suspect there are other factors. I haven't seen research on this, but I suspect that fragmenting care is a problem. So, for example, most asthma care is now delivered by nurses in the practice, and they do an excellent job. But the reality is that when someone has an acute asthma episode, they probably get seen by a GP or by an extended scope practitioner and not that asthma nurse. And that results in a breaking of the continuity in this lack of joined up care. This often results in people not having their longer term therapies considered. I think the other factor is simply time. So when we're all short on time, then optimal care deteriorates, I think. And this is true for every area of medicine, every industry. You're more likely to take an easier, quicker course of action. Let's say you just prescribe another salbutamol. The patient thinks that's what they need. You might have an easier or a quicker conversation when what you really need is to do a full asthma review and check their inhaler technique and then discuss about regime change. And I think the first step to improving asthma care is acknowledging issues like these and then thinking, what can we do about it on an individual and a practice level to make things better? The other thing that we need to be aware about is the two big risk factors for severe and fatal asthma. So firstly, we've got overuse of reliever inhalers such as salbutamol. And then secondly, we've got a history of an asthma attack. For years, the British Thoracic Society and SIGN guidelines have recommended that anyone with an acute exacerbation of asthma needing hospital input should be seen within 48 hours from discharge at their general practice by a GP or asthma nurse. When we've talked to people on the Hot Topics course about this before, they've highlighted that that's a real struggle and most practices don't have mechanisms by which A&E and hospital episodes can be identified and then a follow-up appointment booked. So then this research in the BJGP was looking to quantify exactly how many patients in this situation do get some form of follow-up in general practice after an acute asthma episode. So this was a retrospective cohort study using data from English primary care via the Clinical Practice Research Data Link. And they looked at children with asthma over the age of 5 with at least one asthma-related hospital admission between 2017 and the end of 2019. The primary outcome was a composite of any of the following delivered in primary care within 28 days of hospital discharge. So we're not going for 48 hours here, we're going for 28 days. That's the benchmark. And that composite includes an asthma review, asthma management plan, asthma medication prescription, demonstration of inhaler technique or smoking cessation counselling. They did also check how many people met one of those criteria at 48 hours and a week as well. So out of 17,500 patients that they identified, the results showed that only 18% of children and 14% of adults received any kind of asthma management within 48 hours of hospital discharge. And around 60% of all ages receive some form of asthma management within that 28-day benchmark. Now, clearly, neither of these figures are great, but I think actually that the study flatters even these ropey outcomes. The vast majority of those patients got a tick because they've been prescribed some asthma medication within those 28 days. And in fact, only 13% received an asthma review, only 8% an asthma management plan. Those are the things that are really likely to make a difference to those individuals. Just prescribing more medications is as close to doing nothing as we can do. In fact, I wonder if in the longer run, depending on what we're prescribing, of course, we may actually be doing more harm than good to those individuals and actually putting them in persistent or increasing danger. The paper concludes a significant proportion of patients do not receive timely follow-up in primary care following asthma-related admissions to hospital. The key learning point here for me then is that an episode of acute asthma like this is a marker of poor control and potentially future fatal asthma. The implication is that something needs to change. So it could be that they need some education and change their inhaler technique, but it probably means that they need their regime changing. And if they've already got severe asthma and you don't think they can change their regime, then they're going to need a referral to secondary care, because those patients with severe asthma do have lots of additional options now. So there's multiple biological therapies that could be absolutely life-saving. Maintaining the status quo, just doing another prescription, that is not enough. That is arguably inappropriate. And we just need to think about our own individual practice and the mechanisms within our practice by which we can ensure that we are actively helping this group. Okay, on to our second study. And this one I also came across in the BJGP, although it's not actually published in there. So I found this in the Yonder section. It's well worth going and having a look at. It's in the Life and Times section, which always has lots of really great articles. And Yonder, which has recently been taken over by a GP called Alex Burrell, it's always been a really interesting section, the concept of which is that it reports very briefly on a number of studies which are not in the mainstream medical literature, but may still have important insights into day-to-day practice. And this was a paper that published in Infectious Disease Practice Journal, not one of my usual reads, but I have to say it highlights a very common issue in day-to-day practice. So we all know that most of the time, antibiotics don't help people with a cough. This has been backed up in multiple studies over the years, even if they've got a variety of different risk factors like nasty green sputum or they're quite wheezy. that we would assume might make them higher risk for having a bacterial infection. So in truth, unless you think they've actually got a pneumonia, which they probably don't unless they're sick as a dog, then antibiotics are going to be doing diddly squat. Nevertheless, for all of us, I'm sure there are times when we end up prescribing, and there's no judgment here. I'm exactly the same. It could be that you're particularly worried about that individual, their past medical history, or the symptoms that they've presented with. It could be that it's one of those patients with the classic, oh, I always need antibiotics. Oh, they really helped me last time. And you either don't have the time or perhaps the mental energy by that point to start that conversation with a person, or you know that they're just going to phone up another GP or out of hours, and we're basically just prolonging the agony for everyone. So ultimately, you do that prescription. Whatever, we have an inherent problem with this concept, and that is that routinely these days, we would give 5 days of antibiotics. But people with a viral upper respiratory tract infection or bronchitis will often feel unwell for 1 to 2 weeks and have a cough that could last multiple weeks. And so there's this disconnect between treatment and symptoms. And if we're not really clear about the boundaries here at the outset when we're prescribing, inevitably it ends up in reconsultation. And we've all been here too, many, many times, this week perhaps. And in our minds, the fact that they haven't responded to antibiotics makes it almost a dead cert that this is a virus. But in patients' minds, what it says is that they've got a really bad infection and that they need more antibiotics or another antibiotic, a different one or a combination. And we end up in this kind of antibiotic cough death spiral from which there's no way out. The only solution is to double down on that prescription. The question then that this piece of research titled Within Episode Repeat Antibiotic Prescriptions in Patients with Respiratory Tract Infections, the question that it's trying to answer is how often do we get stuck in this death spiral? This was also a study based on retrospective data pulled out of English general practice once again. This time examining all individuals with a primary care respiratory tract infection consultation for which an antibiotic was prescribed between 2018 and 2022. The primary outcome was a repeat antibiotic prescription within 28 days of that initial consultation. 906,000 patients met their inclusion criteria. So they've got a huge data set to work from here. So their results showed that 1 in 10 adults and children with an upper respiratory tract infection who had been previously prescribed an antibiotic ended up being prescribed a second antibiotic. That's a lot of people, right? And that's not even the amount of people that reconsult. That's just the amount of people who have reconsulted and have subsequently been prescribed a second antibiotic. It feels like we're really making life hard for ourselves here. Now, if you were an adult with a lower respiratory tract infection, it's even greater. So 20% then had a second antibiotic. The median time to this second prescription was 10 days. So that seems to suggest to me that people are given that antibiotic, they take it for a week, their cough hasn't gone, and then they phone us back up again. The authors also highlighted that almost half of antibiotics subsequently prescribed were of the same class and therefore unlikely to offer extra clinical benefit. They conclude that repeat within episode antibiotic use accounts for a significant proportion of all antibiotics prescribed for RTIs and is a prime target for future antimicrobial stewardship interventions. If you want to sell it to clinicians, I think that's very easy. Just say, don't do this. You'll save yourself a whole bunch of work next week. Our third paper was published this week in JAMA journal and is titled Aspirin versus Placebo as Adjuvant Therapy for Breast Cancer. Now, I know that you and I are not the ones who are going to be making major decisions about cancer treatments for our patients, but I thought this was a really important and interesting piece of research. And particularly because I remember a few years ago on the Hot Topics course, we were talking about the potential for aspirin to help long-term outcomes in cancer, particularly at reducing metastases. I've put the link to this research in the podcast description. This was published in 2018 and was a systematic review and meta-analysis of 118 observational studies of aspirin and 18 different cancers. And to cut a long story short, back then, it suggested a 20% reduction in mortality in patients with cancer who took aspirin. With such impressive figures, it begs the question, why haven't we just put all of our patients with cancer on aspirin? That's better results than you've seen for the majority of standard chemotherapies, at least before this newer generation of biological agents has emerged in the last few years. And fast forward to this new research published in JAMA, and I guess then it becomes a cautionary tale about only relying on results of observational trials. This research then was a randomized, placebo-controlled, double-blind trial of 3,000 participants with high-risk non-metastatic breast cancer conducted in America. They either received 300 milligrams of aspirin daily or placebo for 5 years, with the primary outcome was invasive disease-free survival, and a secondary outcome was overall survival. And they stopped the trial early because of futility. At an average of 34 months follow-up, there was no statistically significant difference between the two groups. You might think that that follow-up sounds a little bit short, but the authors, who I guess have every incentive to want to find a positive outcome, actually said that this gives a very low likelihood that additional follow-up would demonstrate a benefit. Quite reasonable to ask, would different breast cancer phenotypes respond in a different way? This study was insufficiently powered to be able to answer that question. The authors do highlight that there is currently a United Kingdom-based trial called the Add Aspirin trial that's actively recruiting at the moment and will be following patients up for many years to come who are also being looked at aspirin as an adjuvant therapy, not just for breast cancer, but also for prostate, colorectal and gastroesophageal cancers too. So in time, we may get a clearer understanding about different types of cancer and their response, if indeed there is any, to aspirin. And that's not to say that there isn't a role in any cancer. So, for example, we do have strong data that shows if you have Lynch syndrome, then high-dose aspirin at 600 milligrams a day does protect against colorectal cancer. But for the hundreds of thousands of women who are living in the UK after a diagnosis of breast cancer, aspirin does not appear to help. Thanks for joining us on the podcast once again. Don't forget to check out the mbmedical.com website with all the courses that are coming up. Don't forget you can subscribe to MB Plus and come on all of them for just over £300 a year. You can always get in touch. Just email hottopics@mbmedical.com. We will be back in a few weeks. See you then. Take care. Bye-bye.